And we're back on another episode of the Philippe Matthews Show, live around the world. Thank you for tuning in. I have a controversial guest. In my opinion, I have a genius guest. Many people would think that this guy is absolutely out of his mind. But once you hear him, listen to him, and what he has to say, I think he is undeniable. His name is Peter Crist, and he is one of the co-founders of LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. Welcome, my friend.
Thank you, Philippe. It's a pleasure to be aboard.
And thank you for the honor of being on. I know you have recently, after 20 years, resigned from LEAP, and you're kind of taking your life back and kind of relaxing and unwinding in your retirement years, and you don't do interviews anymore. So I so appreciate you for taking the time out to be with me. This subject, of course, is a heated subject, but I saw you on some show, and what you were saying was absolutely amazing to me. And then we talked, and I was even more amazed because we know that you're a 20-year or more veteran police officer. And one thought that I had was that you became this anti-prohibitionist during your law enforcement. What you shared with me blew my mind, and that was you were already an anti-prohibitionist before becoming a police officer. How in the world do you even do that? Please take me back to your story, and then we'll start, we'll move from there. But that's insane, Peter. That's insane.
Well, Philippe, the first thing I want to say is thanks for sharing your audience with me. I appreciate what you're doing for me, for LEAP. So it's appreciated on this end too. I had a very different upbringing. I am a product of the end of World War II. I was born at the end of May of 46, which means I was conceived at the end of August of 45. Both of my parents were 42 years old when I was born. I would ask my lovely mother, why did you have me? And she would say, oh, we wanted another baby. And I would ask my father, why did you have me? And he would say, hey, the war was over. Everybody was partying. Boom, there you were. Which is a lot of patient truth. Both of them, my brother and sister were 13 and 14 when I was born. So my parents already had children, you know, and they were done. But I got the privilege of being raised by two wonderful people who were in their 40s and 50s when they raised me, not in their 20s and 30s. So they had a very different view of life than my brother and sister were even raised with. And my brother and sister were both wonderful people, but I just had a different view. Both of my parents were born in 1904. So that means that they were both living in Buffalo, New York in 1920, and they were 16 years old when alcohol prohibition started. And they were 29 years old, married to each other with my sister already born when prohibition ended in 33. The late 50s, I was about 12, 13 years old, a television program came on called The Untouchables. Mm-hmm. And it was about Al Capone and prohibition. And I had two people watching this with me who, first off, you have to understand my parents were open about everything. There was nothing we couldn't talk about. There was nothing off the subject matter. My father, you can hold any position you can defend. That was my father's attitude. I didn't have to agree with him, but I had to be able to defend my position. So they talked to me very openly, and they told me about their life experience. I learned that my great uncle Walter, who was my grandfather's brother, who I knew as being the ace mechanic that ran the garage for the Seal Test ice cream company and kept the trucks on the road, that's what I knew him as. Well, when we had these discussions about prohibition, I find out that between 1920 and 1933, my great uncle Walter owned a boat. And he used to get in that boat sometimes and go across the Niagara River to this place called Canada. And he would buy cases of this stuff and he would put it in the boat and bring it back over to the United States. He was a bootlegger. Okay. He never got arrested for it, but he was a bootlegger. Now, I never looked at my uncle Walter as a criminal. I never thought of him as being a criminal. He made money because he was an opportunist. He got a chance to make some extra bucks because we had bad alcohol and so on and so forth. So this whole idea that these people were criminals was a little shattered for me. Mm-hmm. Secondly, my mm-hmm. father father would show me where the speakeasies used to be, and I would ask my wonderful Baptist mother, why didn't it work? And she would say, because the people didn't support it. Okay. Then I would ask my fallen Catholic father, why didn't it work? And he would say, because it was a stupid idea when they thought of it. Well, I started reading about it. My mother would bring home books on both sides of the issue, whatever, and I read about the history of it, everything. And by the time I got to be about 20, I realized that it took a lot of support to pass a constitutional amendment to ban alcohol. You know, that isn't just a law. We amended the Constitution. So that really weakened my mother's argument. And I realized that my father was right. It was just stupid. People wanted this stuff. They wanted to do this. You're not going to stop them, obviously. And other people are going to supply it for them. So that was about 20. I realized that. And by the time I was doing more reading, I got to be about 21. I came to the idea that, and you got to understand, we're talking about the 60s here. Mm-hmm. Not mm-hmm. the 70s when Nixon had kicked off the drug war. So drugs were illegal, but there wasn't all this insanity about it and so on. And so we didn't have drug units all over the country and stuff like that. But I looked at our drug laws and I said, gee, the only difference between these laws and alcohol prohibition is the thing that's being prohibited. Everything else is exactly the same. All the violent, you know, the gangsters, the illegal, dangerous drugs on the streets, all that stuff when people died of alcohol poisoning because some of the people made it with wood alcohol. Mm-hmm. And you accidentally bought that, you died, all right? So it was just like crack cocaine and heroin is today and so on and so forth. So I realized that that was a stupid idea. Then, because I had made a promise to myself at 17 that I would be retired before I was 45, and I was looking for a 20-year retirement, and after doing my hitch in the Navy, and I always add this, I'm a Vietnam-era veteran, not a Vietnam War veteran, and I always make that clear because I had a couple friends of mine didn't come back from that war, and I had some other friends came back messed up, and for me to even suggest to somebody that I went through that experience dishonors their pain and suffering. But I was in the service during that time. I moved back up to Buffalo, New York. I had two choices. I could become a firefighter or a police officer. My brother and my father are ace mechanics. I can't make a doorknob work right. My lovely wife is the mechanic in my family. So firefighter was kind of off the list. Because you got to understand building structures. You got to be mechanical to be a firefighter.
Sure.
On the other hand, police work is 99% BS. Talking, settling problems, getting stuff fixed. And I figured I was pretty good.
I have to cut you off. In this day and age, in the climate that we're in right now, a police officer saying that most of being a police officer is BS, you're going to, I mean, not that you have not rattled many chains along the way, but my goodness, you have to go into why you feel being a police officer is mostly BS.
Because it's talking to people. It's going into a situation, learning how to talk to people, not really about stuff that's important all the time. I had two reputations on the department I worked on for 20 years. One was that I took longer on most calls than almost every other officer. And the other one was I had fewer return calls than almost every other officer. Because I made sure that everybody that was there understood what I was talking about before I left. And whether it was just they didn't want me to come back or they didn't want anybody to come back, I never went back. Once I went on a call, when I finished it, it was done. So I started taking the exams. I got called by the town of Tonawanda Police. Town of Tonawanda is a community of about 85,000 people, sits on the north edge of the city of Buffalo. They had about 120 officer police department when I came on the job. I got the call for that department, and I had a little sit-down with myself. And I said, you know, this thing you feel about the drugs, now you're going to be in the job of enforcing these laws. Do you want to do it? And if you take the oath, you got to do it. You can't take the job and not do the job. My father, you know, personal integrity and honor. So I said, okay, put your old thinking on the back burner. And also everything I knew about it, about this drug policy, I had learned outside, you know, on my own. Now I was going to be on the job and called upon to do it. So maybe I'm going to change my mind. Maybe I'm going to get on the job and say, I was wrong. You know, this is a good idea. We're helping people to work. By the time I was on the job 4 years, there was something that became very, very clear to me. And that was this. No matter how many drug arrests we made, it didn't make any difference. And what I mean by...
Please define that and go deeper, because do you mean that it didn't make obviously any difference in the totality of the war on drugs that Nixon offered in 1973, or did it not make a difference in the lives of the people whom you were...
It didn't make any difference in the community I lived in. Let me give you an example.
Okay.
We would have a series of house burglars. One of our officers would arrest the burglar. For a while, not forever, but for a while, there wouldn't be any burglaries because we took the burglar off the street, and now you got to wait for another burglar to come along, you know, and there's not one waiting in line. No matter how many drug arrests we made, it never changed what it looked like on the street. The only thing that changed was the faces of the people that we arrested, but the numbers were always the same. There's a little phenomenon that I like to repeat to people. You've seen this television show. You turn on your local station first thing in the morning, and there's a local news story about the big drug bust from last night. We went out with 45 warrants, and we went out and made these drug arrests. And if you got a real young ADA, you might even have them say it to the camera, and this is going to put a big dent in the drug problem as we know it. And there'll be all those very stern police officers standing behind the table piled with guns and drugs and all this stuff. I'm going to tell you something about those people standing behind the table. That's my old profession. They hope they got the kingpin. But they don't know. They grab a bunch of street arrests and everything. They wait about 6-8 months until the trials work their way through court. And there'll be some 25-year-to-life sentences. You figure those are the kingpins, but you don't know for sure. And then there'll be a bunch of 5-7s, you know, the dealers and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Here's how we find out if we got the kingpins. We wait. And if after the sentences come down, we see an increase in shootings and violence on the street, then we know we got the kingpin.
Interesting.
Because if we pull the lead guy out, now people are fighting over to see who's going to be the lead guy.
So if you literally, by taking out the kingpin, you create a turf war.
You create a job opening and a turf war.
Wow.
And the violence. And you can follow this in your community. You can see it after every big arrest. Well,
this is basically what you just explained to me, basically, is a hamster on a wheel.
Exactly.
There is no end to that.
No. And here's the deal. The violence will last about 2 or 3 months. And then the violence calms down. You know what we know then? It's time to start another 2-year investigation. Because there's a kingpin. Okay,
and we got to go. New guy on the block that's controlling that turf.
You know what didn't change during that whole process? The availability of drugs on the street.
Now, see, this is fascinating because you know I've been doing a lot of research on this, obviously, and which is one of the reasons why I wanted you on the show. And you know, when Nixon said, "Hey, you know, a war on drugs," you know, we talked about this earlier—the militarization of the police. And literally having almost the same firepower as the military, but nothing's changed other than this incredible incarceration rate that has made us number one in the world for locking up its citizens. What's going on with this war on drugs? And then, of course, you know, you had Ford, you had Carter, then you had Ford. And then Reagan came in and started the new war on drugs, took it to a next level, which it was almost like a propaganda campaign, because when he came out with that, crack cocaine wasn't introduced till 2 years later on the streets. So it was like kind of gearing up and getting ready. And here we are today. Nothing's changed.
Crack cocaine.
Why has nothing changed?
Crack cocaine is a product of our drug policy. If drugs had been legal, crack cocaine never would have been invented. Let me give you an example.
Whoa. Okay. I don't have any hair, Peter, so you can't blow my hair back like that by saying things like that on air. I just heard that you said that crack cocaine never would have been invented if or created if there was no war on drugs. Are you serious about this?
Let me give you an example from what we learned in alcohol prohibition. Before alcohol prohibition, the primary way people consumed alcohol in this country was wine and beer. Then we went into alcohol prohibition for 13 years. After we came out of alcohol prohibition after 13 years, the primary way we consumed alcohol was hard whiskey. Because the gangsters made more money off of hard whiskey than they did off of, the wine industry disappeared during prohibition. And the beer industry hung around because people still wanted it, but the big money came from the hard whiskey. We didn't switch back to being a primary beer and wine drinking country until 1970. It took us almost 40 years to go out of that change that was created by alcohol prohibition. When you institute a prohibition, you create an underground economy. The underground economy makes more money off of making things pure, thus crack cocaine. All right. If that had been a legitimate open business, nobody would have invented it. If you wanted cocaine, you would go to the store, you would buy it if you were old enough, whatever, and you would use it, and there wouldn't have been a reason to invent crack cocaine.
What you're telling me, Peter, then, is the actual this started obviously not with Reagan in terms of this new level of incarceration, but really it started with Nixon and. Right. That we would not be in the situation we're in right now if it were not for that mandate. So what would have been the alternative?
Let me give you an example.
Or to let people do what their consenting adults do? What's your position on this?
Let me give you an example. Baltimore. The poor area of Baltimore. Mm-hmm. You're a kid growing up in the poor area of a city like that, right? Mm-hmm. Who's the only people in the neighborhood that's got money?
The hood is going to be the drug dealers.
Okay, so now you're 12, 13 years old, and a guy up at the corner wants you to do him a little favor and go over and take this over to some guy, and he hands you $20 to do it. Mm-hmm. And then it happens again. And by the time you're 16, 17, now you're drawn into the trade. You don't have an expectation of going to college. You don't have an expectation of another job. These people are giving you money. And then you get busted at 17, you get a criminal record. And we put you away for a few years, and then we bring you back. You know, I like to remind everybody about this, about all the people we got in prison. Mm-hmm. More than 90% of the people that we have locked up in America today have one thing in common. And I don't even guess, because you're not going to get it. Here's what it is. They're coming home. 90% of them are not in there for life. They're in there for a sentence, and then they're coming home. And I have to ask you, are we sending them home better than they went away or worse?
Mm.
And why are we shocked at this? You know, you have to understand the mechanism of it. And it's...
one would say that literally prison trains you to be a criminal more so than the act that got you in.
I want to point out one other thing about prison because I think it's real important. There's nobody in America today that doesn't know that there are two escaped prisoners from New York State.
Mm-hmm.
You see that all the news shows, because it's such a big story that two guys broke out of a prison. I tell people all the time that if you want to know about what is stupid and insane about this drug policy, the next time you hear the term drug-free school, drug-free city, I want you to know this. We have the largest prison system on the planet Earth. And we have the most efficient prison system on the planet Earth. If you're going to count efficiency this way, we put you in there. And you don't get out unless we let you out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The reason that those two guys escaping is such a national story is because it's so rare that anybody escapes. So we do that well, all right? In that huge, efficient prison system, would you like to take a guess at how many drug-free prisons there are in America today? Because the answer is zero.
I would say zero, yes.
So now,
you can't keep drugs out of the prison. How in the heck can you keep it out of society?
Well, you talk about the high school, and I don't want drugs in the schools. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not promoting this. I think we should keep drugs at school. We don't see too many kids in school that are selling alcohol to each other, you know, and that's legal and regulated. So we have a way to handle that. But I am just saying that the difference between the people in the school and the people in the prison is the people in the school have all their liberties and the people in the prison have given up all theirs, and we can't keep drugs out of the prisons. Who is going to be delusional enough to think you're going to keep them out of a free society? So what we have to do, well, we were talking about it before. Sure. There was two movies made from an event that happened in New York City a number of years ago in the late 60s. One of the movies was called The French Connection. Mm-hmm. And the other movie was called Panic in Needle Park.
Mm-hmm.
And it was about the same drug bust. By the way, the French Connection drug bust was 9 pounds of heroin. Not tons. 9 pounds of heroin. We made that bust. They made the movie Panic in Needle Park because the panic was because there was a shortage for about a month and a half of heroin on the streets because they had made this drug bust. And then the French Connection was about the whole drug bust. 9 pounds of heroin, and they made 2 movies out of it. We seize this stuff today by the ton, and there's never a panic in Needle Park. There's never a shortage on the street. Mm-hmm. There's never, and we've gone from that to this with this policy. You know, I think it was Einstein that said that the definition of a genius is a person that does the same thing over and over again. The definition of insanity is a person who does the same thing over and over again, expecting different results.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You cannot describe this drug policy any better than that.
Here we are today, and now we are softening the marijuana laws. Colorado, first state to legalize it. Huge. They so big. The story is so big. They have a TV show on CNN about this couple who's opening up the first legalized marijuana shop. When the show debuted and they got they became legal, whenever that date hit, I think it was January, 14 or 15, whatever that was, people literally came in all over the world to buy. They say, well, I want to be the first person to buy legalized marijuana in the world, and I'm from Singapore, I'm from Russia, I'm from Chile. It was every people all over the world. It's crazy. We don't see the state or the city of the state of Colorado, the city of Breckenridge. I've heard the crime rate has actually gone down. What's going on here with this? Because you don't believe, and I want to make this clear, you don't believe drugs should necessarily be out there for just mad consumption. You do believe in a level of regulation, just as alcohol is regulated. Is that right?
I believe that drugs are so dangerous, they must be controlled. And even though we call this policy drug control policy, the current policy we have in effect is actually total decontrol of the whole marketplace. Who determines the purity of the drugs that are sold on the street? Food and Drug Administration? No, the mob. Who determines the distribution points for these drugs? The local regulators and the locals? No, the mob. Who determines the age limits who they're going to sell these drugs to? The government? No, the mob. We have turned this whole thing over to them. And it's all motivated by very good purposes. I mean, the people on the other side of this think that they're helping people by doing this, by stopping them from using drugs, but they aren't stopping them and they aren't helping them. I want to see a regulated and controlled marketplace. I want to see kindergarten through 12th grade drug education schools. And I don't want it to be drug education, just say no. I want it to be, here's the drug. If you take it, this is what it does. This is safe, you, and educate people to it. Like we're starting to do with drinking and starting to educate people to realize it isn't just up to them. We have to bear with them. I think we made a terrible mistake when we raised the drinking age to 21. I think all we did was create another quasi-legal, you know, a gray market for kids to buy drugs at. 18's age for that. Start regulating and controlling it. We have to educate people about this stuff. You can't even talk openly about drug use to people because they say you're going against it. One of the other things I want to say is a lot of people think that if we legalize drugs, we're condoning. Mm-hmm. You know, we're saying it's okay, and that isn't what we're doing. We're accepting the reality of the world we live in and realizing that just because we think it's a bad idea that you should do something doesn't mean you do. And unless you're hurting other people or other people's property, you should be allowed to live the life you want to live. That's mm-hmm. what I call liberty. Mm-hmm. That's what freedom means to me, to be the person. One of the reasons I just resigned from the board was to finally be retired, to not have anybody that I owe anything to except my lovely wife, you know?
Sure, sure. You said that when we talked earlier, you shared with me the two types of crime that I thought was very powerful, and I want you to speak to that, because sure. the issue was, you know, you have if you legalize drugs, regulate it like you do alcohol. I think I asked you the question of, well, what about those who have a propensity for addiction? What about those who would feel more comfortable experimenting, and what would the consequences be therein? And your answer was,
well, what we were talking about the two types of laws. And by the way, just on the addiction thing, what do we do to alcoholics that are addicted? If you're an alcoholic in this country today, and you do not drink and drive, and you do not hurt other people or other people's property, what do we do to you?
What do we do to an alcoholic? Well, we try to send them through treatment, or some of them.
If they request it, we help them. We give them treatment. We give them education. We also guarantee them a purity of product, so they don't have to worry if they buy their alcohol, they're going to go blind or die or something like that. We give them safe places to purchase and use the product in. And if they want help, we give them help. Okay. If you're a heroin addict and we catch you, we send you to prison for 5 years. Mm. Same addiction, same problem. The only difference is what you're addicted to. Mm-hmm. When you're talking about the two types of laws, there's a Latin phrase that explains the two types of laws we have in society. And it's called mala in se and mala prohibitum. Mala in se are crimes that are crimes because they're crimes. There's a victim. For instance, you and I are walking down the street, and we see this woman walking down the other side of the street, and a guy runs up behind her, punches her in the back of the head, knocks her to the ground, grabs her purse, and runs away. I don't have to explain to you why that's against the law, do I?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, that should be. Where's the cop? Get a cop.
Right.
Now we walk down another block, and we see a guy walk up to a guy on a street corner, smile at him, shake hands, have a little conversation, hand him some money. He hands him a package. They smile at each other and walk away. And I tell you, that's against the law. I got some explaining to do, don't I? You didn't see any. You looked at two happy people. They seem to be getting along. What's the crime? Mala in se are crimes that have victims. Mala prohibitum are laws we make in society because they're morality laws. They are things that a majority of us don't like people doing, so therefore we think.
You were sharing with me that it was one of those aspects of that is the legalizing of gay marriage. It used to be a crime in this country. That's crazy.
Well, we had a law the whole time I was in the police department. It was illegal to be gay in New York State. The call was a wonderful law, by the way. The law was the consensual sodomy law. And it made sodomy between two consenting adults perfectly legal if they were married to each other. And if they weren't married to each other, it was a Class B misdemeanor, which is a crime, okay? And that's how we arrested gay people for decades in this country, just for being gay, okay? We used to arrest women for attempting to vote. We used to arrest slaves for attempting to be free men. And send them back to being slaves again. We have a whole history of this. This isn't anything new. We're winding it down, but we're not seeing that these drug prohibitions When you have acts between consenting adults, and the two words that are important to remember here are consenting and adults. We're not talking about doing this to kids. That's against the law, okay? But as long as they're consenting adults, if you make that activity illegal, first off, I'm going to guarantee you this, it's not going to stop. The people who want to do it are going to keep doing it. Secondly, it's going to create more crime in society because now this activity with no victims is now against the law and the police have to go out and deal with it. And if there's money connected to this activity, it creates violence in society. Because if they have a dispute over the money, they can't go to the court system to settle the dispute, so they go to the streets. It doesn't stop the behavior. You know what you have to do in these types of situations, control it. Mala and say should be law enforcement. That's what we're there for. Mala prohibitum should be handled by family, church, education, and the healthcare system. These are morality issues that we should teach people about. It should never be a law enforcement function. And if you get us out of that business, you're going to see us have a much better relationships with the communities we work in. Because people aren't worrying about the little thing they're doing, the little gambling they're doing, or the little this that they're doing, or the little that.
That's funny. I'd never thought of it that way, but you're absolutely right. You said the reason that a lot of people are timid to talk to the cops is because they're probably engaged in what would now be considered illegal activity. And so they're not really sharing about the actual crime that's going on because they don't want you to come in and find out that they might have some marijuana or they might have some other illicit drugs or what have you. And so the actual law itself creates more of a separation makes it inhibitive to have community policing. Is that what is that your position?
Exactly. Exactly. My position. In fact, it's interesting. Back when I was on the road during tours and stuff like that, we do a lot of Rotary clubs, Kiwanis, you know, those kind of groups. One of the bits that I did was I would ask my audience to raise their hand if they knew an illegal drug user. Every time I did that, roughly a third to a half of the people put their hands up. And then I would say, all you people that didn't put your hands up, you're all lying. They'd look at me kind of funny. I'd say, no, don't misunderstand me. I don't mean that you're intentionally lying. But I guarantee you that if tomorrow drugs become legal, every one of you in this room is going to all of a sudden realize that you knew a whole bunch of illegal drug users. You just didn't know they did it because they didn't talk to you about it. Okay? I'll give you an example. I have noticed in the past few years, all of a sudden in America, there appears to be gay people everywhere. Mm-hmm. Now, it wasn't like this 10 years ago. 10 mm-hmm. years ago, there weren't any gay people anywhere. You never saw any on television. They weren't anywhere. Mm-hmm. Now, all of a sudden, they're everywhere. So I ask myself the question that has to be asked. If there's more gay people, why are all these straight people turning gay? Well, mm-hmm. we all know better than that. The only thing that changed was the rest of us stopped being jerks about it. And mm-hmm. now these people are willing to admit who they are. There aren't more of them. They are just more visible. And when we legalize drugs, when we finally wake up and we do that, we're going to be amazed at how many drug users there are in this country. And it isn't because people are going to start using drugs. It's going to be because all these people are going to be out of the closet and out in the open. And we're going to be able to
deal with. I'm going to put you back on the spot again, which is damn near impossible, but I'm going to try. The hippie generation, the 60s, oh my God, you know, the opium, the drugs and everything. Oh, we've got to stop this. This morality, the kids are out here and they're free and they're running around and they're smoking pot and they're taking this and doing that. What are we, oh my God, we're losing our children. What is this generation going to, you know, of course, some of them grew up and be presidents of the United States, but that's not a point. I tried to do that with a straight face. I could not. You know, are we going to go back to this whole hippie generation of the free thing and peace, love, and all of that crazy hippie stuff and a free for all? What's going on here with this anti-prohibition thing?
You know, it's interesting that the people that you're talking are people that by their presence offends other people. The hippies, that is. People are bothered by them being there, okay? People don't understand that I happen to be personally an atheist, okay? Mm-hmm. I am not anti-religious in any way, mm-hmm. and I am not evangelical about my atheism. I'm not trying to convince anybody else. If somebody passed a law tomorrow to close a church, I would be the first one standing in the doorway of that church keeping it open.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not because I agree with what they say in there. It's because that I know that my liberty to be who I am is embedded in their liberty to be who they are. And if they can have their liberty taken away from them, then tomorrow somebody can come up and take mine away from me. Okay. So I have to, there's a guy from Germany, he was a Lutheran pastor, his name was Niemöller. And there's a famous quote from him. And he said, when they came to take the communists away, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a communist. And when they came to take the gays away, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a gay. And when they came to take the Jews away, I didn't say anything because I wasn't a Jew. And when they came to take me away, there was nobody left to say anything.
Mm. Wow.
And that's where liberty resides. If you walk around in the society that you live in for 24 hours observing everything you can observe and you see nothing that offends you, trust me, you do not live in a free society. Because living in a, and don't misunderstand me, just because you see stuff that offends you doesn't mean you live in a free society too. Right. I mean, if I would have been in Germany in 1938, I would have been offended by almost everything I saw, and that certainly would. But if you think you live in a free society and everything is pleasing to your sight, that means other people are being denied the right to be who they want to be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we have to protect that. I fight to protect your liberty, not for you, but for me. Because if your liberty can be denied, then mine can too.
So that brings me to as we're winding down here, that brings me to Leap. You and four other people, why did you decide? I mean, you could have easily just said, you know what, I'm going to have my beliefs, I'm going to have my ideology about this, and I'm going to retire and live and lead a normal life. But you literally said, okay, I'm going to become an actual activist on this. This is bigger than just me living my life in my community. So talk to me about how Leap came to be with the other cats that you formed this with, and why. What was the purpose and mission of this organization?
Okay, when I first retired, I moved from the Buffalo area to Syracuse, New York area, because my lovely wife had moved down here for a job 2 years before I retired. Mm-hmm. So we relocated to Syracuse. I got out of the police department. I've been arguing about this with my peers for 20 years. And I just want to say, by the way, as far as the job I did, I got promoted at 15 years of lieutenant and at 17 years to captain. So I did my job very well. Even though I disagreed with the policy, it didn't stop me from being promoted. And I was very vocal about it. Okay, we'd make drug busts and I'd say, this ain't our job. But it's what we're paid to do. I'll do it. But it's not our job.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a passion of mine. I've been talking about it for a long time. I couldn't stay silent. I had to say something. So I figured I'd get into it. I retired in April of 89. I called down to Washington, D.C. to call Normal. Now, marijuana was never my issue, but Normal was the only organization I knew about.
Mm-hmm.
So I called them up and I said, you got anything coming up? And they said, we got a conference coming up in October. This was October of 89. So I booked myself into the camp. When I retired, my lovely wife, Paula, said to me, so what are you going to do next? I said, I'm going to get involved in this prohibition stuff. I have to do it. I can't be silent about it. I got to do it. And I made two promises to her. I said, I don't know if I'll make any money doing this, and I haven't. But I said, I promised her it wouldn't cost us anything.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So now the first couple of years it did. I had to pay my own way down to the conference and stuff like that. But I had to get to know. When I got to that Normal conference, I met people that were from a conference that had happened the week before. And that organization, I had never heard of it before, was called DPF, Drug Policy Foundation. Mm. And the people I talked to there were talking about what I was talking about. Mm. Not just.
Okay.
So the next year, I booked myself into the DPF conference, and I started meeting people there. I wrote some letters to the editor, made some call-ins on some talk shows here at Syracuse, got invited to be on a couple of them and stuff like that. A couple radio, CNY had an hour talk thing every day on the television. I got on there a couple times. And a guy called me up in about 92, and he's a local guy, Nick Eiley, and he said, we read your letter in the paper. We've seen you on television. We know you're involved in this. Do you want to, we're starting a group. Do you want to be part of it? And I said, no, but I'll work with you. I okay. hate being part of the group. I find our species individually infinitely interesting. I have never met an uninteresting human being. I've met some that have and I haven't liked, but never that weren't interesting because they're all unique. They're all different.
Absolutely.
I find us in groups to be highly overrated. And the reason I say that is in order to be part of a group, you have to sacrifice a little bit of yourself. And a lot of times that thing that you sacrifice is the thing that made you interesting in the first place.
Very well said.
Not very good with groups, but I told them I'd work with them. Well, I became the primary spokesperson for ReconsiDer.
Okay.
And they would now send me to the conferences for DPF down in Washington. And I would go down there. And in 93, 94, I'd go down and I'd talk about legalization. By 95, I'd say legalization and I'd hear, don't use the L word. We're talking about, they were moving to the marijuana thing, to the regulation and stuff. And they didn't want people talking about legalizing other drugs and stuff like that. All through the 90s, I talked about this idea I had for a law enforcement group to speak to this issue. Because I felt that hearing a voice of law enforcement would be a powerful voice in this issue, because we're the ones that are given the task to enforce these things. Sure. And people would say to me, gee, it's a great idea. You ought to do it. And I would say to them, I am not the guy to run it. I have no interest in doing it.
You weren't the guy.
Right. You find somebody that wants to run it, I'll be glad to work with them, but I don't want to run it. In 97, a guy came to the conference for the first time by the name of Jack Cole. He was a retired narc from New Jersey State Police, 16 years as an undercover narcotics officer, and he had realized how foolish this was, and he came to this DPF conference. We got him on board with ReconsiDer. He became the other spokesperson for ReconsiDer. In late 2001, I get a call from Jack at home, and he says to me, did you hear about that offer from MPP? MPP is Marijuana Policy Project, and they had thrown $50,000 out on the table for anybody that wanted to start a law enforcement.
Wow.
And he said to me, do you want to do it? And I wrote on the phone. I said to him, do you want to run it? And he said, after a little pause, yeah, I'll run it. I said, do you want to run it? And he said, yeah, I'll run it. I said to him, do you want to run it? Yeah, I said, three times, I'll run it. And I said, okay, 6 months from now, when you're calling me on the phone and complaining how much work it is, I'm going to remind you I gave you three chances to say no. So he and a guy by the name of Howard Wooldridge, a guy by the name of Dan Salerno, who was a former Detroit cop, got off on a medical disability, got injured on the job, and a working cop from Canada named John Gator, who was still on the job, became the other four of us, and the five of us put together a group. So the way I like to explain the leap to people, and I always start out by saying, tell me if I don't sound arrogant enough, I, Peter Crist, had the idea for Leap. And if it hadn't have been for Jack Cole, it would still be an idea. Because he's the one that did all the hard work. So then we started putting it together. We started to get some funding. We got the guy that was doing booking for us with ReconsiDer came over to Leap. He started doing bookings with us in the Rotary Clubs. We got more and more attention. We started bringing more and more people on board. And now we got a proposal in on the UN Drug Treaty. We are an NGO with the UN. We have chapters in about four different countries right now for Leap.
Wow.
In order to be, anybody can be a member of Leap. But in order to be a spokesperson for Leap, in order to speak for Leap, you have to be from law enforcement. Because you cannot dismiss us. You know, you can't. I'll give you an example. One of our speakers was doing his first debate out in California against the head of the narcotics unit out there. And he calls me up on the phone about a week before the debate. He said, I got a debate coming up. I said, yeah, I know. Good luck with it. He said, you've done a bunch of these. He says, you got any suggestions? I said, yeah, I'll tell you how I open any debate I do, if it's with a law enforcement person. He said, what's that? I said, I stand up at the mic and I say, let me tell you what I and my opponent agree completely about. All these drugs are terrible. Don't use any of them. They're horrendous. They're terrible. We agree about that. We are not here to discuss that today. What we are here to discuss today is what is the best policy for this country to follow to deal with this problem. My opponent is going to recommend a policy that has 14 and 15 year old kids selling drugs on the street and gangsters and terrorists making money off the drug market. I, on the other hand, am going to suggest a policy that has a regulated licensed marketplaces, age limit set, control over purity, control. You'll have to decide which way you think is better. And he calls me up about an hour after the debate is over with, and he says, thank you. I said, why? He said, I used your opening. He said, I could hear all his armor hit the floor. Because he had no argument. He was going to stand up. These drugs are terrible. Give you that. I'm not saying these drugs are okay. That is not part of this at all. I don't think alcohol is okay. I think alcohol can be a very damaging substance. I don't think tobacco's okay. But if somebody decided that we should prohibit tobacco, I'll guarantee you it ain't going to go away, and people are going to start making a whole lot of money selling it in the underground. So
you were talking earlier about the difference between morality law versus crime laws. Here, I'm in Sacramento. There's a suburb of Sacramento called Davis. This is something I didn't know. I am a lover of cigars. And they just passed a law in Davis where you cannot smoke in your house or in your backyard. You will be cited and taken to jail and arrested if you smoke in your house and one of the neighbors smells it, or if you smoke out in your backyard in your canopy or your patio or whatever. You can be arrested. So I'm sorry that.
Good luck with that.
We already have the tobacco laws. We failed.
I know. There is no end to stupidity in our species. So these things do not surprise me. You got to remember all that. Whatever.
Tell me again the definition. I think we talked about this on the phone. The difference between fascists and liberty.
Oh, okay. The two words that I have my own definition for. Fascist. I always say this to people before I say what I'm going to say next. I had a very good friend of mine that always said that there's only two kinds of people in the world. The kind of people that think there's only two kinds of people in the world, and the kind of people that are smarter than that, okay? So I understand that. But I'm going to say there's two kinds of people in the world. There's the fascists, and there's the normal people. Here's how you tell the difference between the two. When a normal person has a great new idea, what the normal person does is they actualize it. If other people admire it, they share it with them. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm a capitalist. They may share it for a profit. But if requested, they sell it to other people. Mm-hmm. When a fascist has a great new idea, the next thought that comes into the fascist head is, this is such a good idea. We ought to make everybody do it this way.
Mm.
And that's the difference. And you can be a fascist anything, Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, Green. I don't care. As long as you think you've got your right to impose your views on other people, you're a fascist. The other word, and it's even more important to me, in fact, it's the center of my life. The reason I wanted to be retired before I was 45 is because I wanted liberty. I didn't want to have to sell my time to other people in order to live. I wanted to be able to just be me, okay? So liberty has always been important to me. I define liberty as the right to be as stupid as you choose to be, as long as you do not harm another person or another person's property. Now, most people I say that to think I'm just trying to be silly or make a joke, but I am dead serious, and I'll tell you why. I have noticed in my reading of history that there is a phenomenon that I refer to as stupid crazy genius. And here's how it plays out over time. You and I grew up together in a small town. We had this friend named Tom. I went off to college. I've been away for like 20 years. I come back to town for a visit, and I run into you. I say, hey, Philippe, how you doing? You say, oh, good. We're talking. I say, how's Tom doing? You say, oh, Tom. We thought he was smart. I'm telling you, he's stupid. He's over on the hill over there. And are you ready for this? He thinks he's going to catch light inside a glass ball and light the world. I mean, how stupid could you be? 2 years later, I'm back in town again. I run into you and say, Philippe, how you doing? You say, hey, before I even say it, you said, you hear about Tom? He's crazy. He's out of his mind. He's wasted 4 years of his life on this stupid hill over there with this light in the ball thing. A year later, I'm back in town, and before I get a chance to say hello, out of your mouth comes, you're about Tom? He's a genius. He caught light inside a glass ball. He's going to light the world. Every person that comes up with a new idea within the group is labeled by the group as being stupid. If they persist in that idea, we call them crazy. And if it turns out that it really was a good idea, we then call them geniuses. Now, before I go on any further, I want to make it perfectly clear, far more than 95% of the stupid, crazy people are in fact stupid and crazy. They're never going to be geniuses. I admit that wholeheartedly, but here's the problem. If we get rid of them when they're stupid and crazy, we're also going to get rid of the geniuses too.
Wow.
Because we don't know until the whole thing plays out which ones are going to be the geniuses.
Wow.
So we got to accept this behavior from people just for our own benefit so that we can have a cell, so we can do this. This is geniuses that invented our ability to do this. Across the country, we're looking at each other around halfway around the world. I was talking to a guy sitting in the desert a few years ago. He's one of our members, and he took a job training border guards in Iraq. He's sitting in a tent in the middle of the desert, and I'm sitting here at home, and we're seeing each other and talking to each other halfway around the world. And if you want to know the impact of that, let me give you an example of how things have changed. King George sat in England for about a month and a half making decisions based on the concept that he still owned the colonies. Because it took a month and a half for the note to float across the pond and told you lost. Today, that is a 5-second phone call. George, yeah, George here. We won, you lost, goodbye. That's how things have changed thanks to the geniuses. And we need the geniuses, so that means we got to protect all these other people just to get the benefit of that.
So we need to protect and not prohibit.
Exactly, exactly. And again, you're not allowed to hurt other people or other people's property. That's the rules. As soon as you create a victim, then we got... But, you know, it's interesting. There's a book I like to recommend to everybody. It was written by a guy by the name of Peter McWilliams. And the title of the book is Ain't Nobody's Business If You Do. The old Mae West song. That's the title. He's got a subtitle on it that changed my vocabulary. Because the subtitle is The Absurdity of Consensual Crime in a Free Society. Well, I read that term, consensual crime, and it took another term completely out of my vocabulary, because I used to call that victimless crime. And when I said victimless crime to people, people would give me such a list of imaginary victims, it would knock your eyes out. Okay. But when I changed it to consensual adult activity, those arguments all go away. And that's what we're talking. If you really believe in liberty, that means you got to protect the people who are doing things you don't like them doing. You know, if there was only one right way to do it, we would only have one church in this country. There's only one right way. You know.
Well said.
And again, I want to throw this in here at the end. You know what? The very first prohibition that we ever heard of, any historical record at all, the first prohibition that ever happened on this planet.
When was that?
It started with these words: "Do not eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil."
Oh boy, that's biblical.
Garden of Eden.
Garden
only
of Eden.
Only two people had to be watched: Adam and Eve, the cop, the creator. Right? Should have worked. I could have made it work. If I would have been the cop in the garden, I would have put a fence around the tree. I would have sat out in front of it and just chased him away. That would have been the end. But the problem is, it was trying to prohibit consensual adult behavior. And those two people who were given that power after they were created, free will, that was a grant from the creator. And that free will,
you know, they probably have you come back on the show and just talk about religion. I know we'll have a heck of a time on that, because if you want to talk about prohibition, morality in this country and around the world, 90%, 99% of all laws are backed by religion.
Exactly. And that's what we're doing. And we're picking. I always tell people, if you want to use the police to enforce morality in your community, here's a question you have to ask yourself first. Whose morality are we going to enforce? Mm-hmm. The Catholics have an interpretation of morality. Mm-hmm. Protestants have very different interpretations throughout all the Protestant religions. Jews have their own. Islam has their. Hindus have their. Which one should we put into law and make everybody live by? And I always tell people, before you give me an answer, read the First Amendment just one more time, because it says something about that in there. And that's what the problem is with these mala prohibitum. And I love it, because the Latin phrase is mala prohibitum, and that's where the word prohibition comes from. So it's prohibition is right embedded in that type of law. Mm-hmm. And that is morality policing. And we're better than that. We get so much benefit out of freedom and liberty. And then we always are trying to take it away from the people we don't like. You know, it's pathetic. But, it's interesting. I tell people this all the time. If you're over the age of 30 and you see anything that surprises you, you have not been paying attention. By the age of 30, everything's gone by you. Whether it's, I don't mean in your personal life, but I mean on television or whatever. It's you have to understand. And the other thing I always like to remember is, because I think we forget this very quickly. Currently, there are 7 billion variations of you on this planet.
Yeah.
I happen to be one of them.
That's right. That's
there are
right.
7 billion variations of me. You happen to be one of them. We are all the same, but we're all just a little bit different. And that difference is what gives us all the wonderful things we have.
And this wonderful conversation and this wonderful career that you've had, but also that wonderful mind that you have. Don't ever lose
don't
that.
Ever lose
love that. Your mind. Love your mind. The organization is LEAP, Law Enforcement Against the Prohibition. My good friend Peter Christ is retiring from that, has resigned from that. He is getting ready to just kind of chill the rest of his life. He's achieved his goals. And one of the greatest goals that he has achieved is this incredible voice of reason that I want you to take a look at. Go back, watch this show, listen to what he's saying. We're not saying we want everybody to turn into a drug addict and a zombie, but your civil liberties, look at that and look at what we've done. Did we get it right? No, we haven't. We lost the war on drugs, and we lost most of generations of youth, fathers, brothers, uncles, sons that will never have families that will never be able to regenerate again as a result of these laws. That being said, Peter, thank you so much for being with me and taking this time.
Philippe, I want to thank you for sharing your audience with me. And this is not a good policy. It has to come to an end. If we talk about it, it'll change. The only reason that bad things continue to happen is because good people stay silent.
Well said. Thank you, my friend, for being with me.
Thank you.